Oh my God, it was a rough day. It was a rough day. We had a rough day. For anyone who weren't watching, this is the game we're gonna review. Warwick game, or excuse me, not a Warwick game. No, that was our warm-up game. The Skarner game. Skarner game. You can see why I want to review one of these games though. They're the unusual kind of Warwick's more meta nowadays, which is actually why I tried him out. I'm trying to get him in my rotation of my champion pool for jungle now that. His rework has sort of been figured out. I want to start to get a hang of it myself. I've seen it played a lot, so I think I'm starting to get the gist of it. I just need to start developing the mechanics with it. But we're gonna focus on Skarner because I whipped out the Skarner, good old pocket pick from when he was first reworked. I played a lot of Skarner. It felt really strong. There were some nerfs that came in, some tweaks over a few patches, and he still feels really good where he landed. He's definitely you got to go the Gotta go for the tank. There is some ability to use a little bit of mana with him. I think there's an ability that scales off of mana, or let me actually check this out so I don't give you guys poor information. Skarner Wiki. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was his shield slightly gives more mana. Or it's slightly based off of his mana. No, it's based off his max health. That's what it was. I knew it was some non-ability power damage stat. So because of that, not only do you want to be tanky just because you want to be tanky, you want to get those stats, but you also get a larger shield. So he scales into being a bigger tank with tankiness. So that feels good. And as we can see once we're loading in here, we had a team that I think really warranted a tank pick. At least at the point of the game. Let me do one more check here. Make sure you guys can see the draw tool. Can you see that? Perfect. So once we load in, I can actually show you guys what the composition was because I've already forgot it, even though I was just staring at it. Yes, we had an Annie, a Varus, Brand, and Garen. Garen was actually the pick after me. So we didn't see that we actually did have some tankiness coming out of the top lane. I think there was even a hover. I mean, Twitch chat can remind me, but I think there was a hover of somebody who was a little more squishy, a little bit more of a fighter tough. But we ended up going with the Skarner. And the initiation with Annie, I can follow up that. I have my E that I can turn into a stun by auto attacking to proc it. I have my ultimate. I took Flash. I was debating taking Ghost, but I ended up taking Flash just because I thought the Flash ult would be too good to get a really key pick if someone like a Fizz got out of control if Annie didn't do well in lane. Didn't turn out to be that much of a problem. Annie had it down. So I was hanging out here, waiting by the spire. Once I saw Annie was taking it, I wanted to poke around here a little bit. And this is a really ambitious play by Renekton. But at the same time, it's fairly standard because everybody takes bot first. Like their bot side jungle is what they start first. Pretty much everybody, just for a better leash. It's actually a little bit debated because in the pro scene, people will start Raptors with certain champions. I'm not sure if Skarner would be one that can actually pull it off. His Q does a little ring of AoE around him, so he might actually be able to be one of those people who can do it. But for example, if you have a Ziggs, he'll like Q it once, and then you can take all of the experience, and all the little guys will get you too, so you can finish the camp off a little bit more healthily, actually use your abilities in a rotation, and then go to red buff. So this is a bit ambitious, yet still seeing this get capped means it's probably safe to go here. And he did poke up pretty safely. So he's rewarded there. And that is really good because it's gonna throw me off when I go into that side of my jungle to finish out my first clear. I'm gonna move a lot slower. This gives you, I think, increased attack speed and increased move speed and also increased mana regen, if I remember correctly. It's been a while since I've checked that up, even though I just had the wiki open. But I'm pretty sure those are the three stats it gives you. So I'm gonna go a full clear path with Skarner just because I'm looking for as much as possible to push myself towards six. All I want is that ultimate. Now I can, with as you saw right there, the E to to proc the stun on an enemy. And my W, my shield, gives me a speed buff. My ganks aren't the worst. I can actually get some good ganks off pre-6. Well, let's keep it real. I'm Skarner. I want to be 6. I don't want to gank. I want that. Can I be 6? I just want to be 6. Let me be 6. So, we're looking for that. Annie, being a good guy, Annie, and not wanting to put herself at risk of an early all-in from the Fizz, actually goes and caps that for me. My heart just goes pitter-patter. A pitter-patter. A Mumu is actually looking for a cheeky invade, if I recall correctly. Maybe this was a little bit later into the game here. He went for a gank on Annie first. Yeah, he does wind up finding the gank on Annie. She survives it, though. Very well played by Annie to have a good reaction time to just flash right out of there. And taking from one of the minor points we keep hovering over, or we keep touching on, rather, in these games, is to be more willing to just burn those summoner spells. Unfortunately, though, since she did burn it, she does wind up getting killed. I'm looking top this whole time, thinking, okay, well, shoot, there goes Annie. But let's try and answer it. They've got a kill. I got to answer it. Let's get Renekton. See if we can get Garen rolling. If we can mitigate that, it'll become the Noodle Fest top, even though it's Renekton, and then Renekton doesn't get to do his job. Now, as you see here, let me actually just give you the full Twitch chat treatment. Ping. The full solo queue. Ping. What happened here? What happened here was, I was clicking on him. I'm fairly certain I had right clicked on him after I threw out that E. And I just couldn't get him. He just sliced and diced right through me. I don't know. Like, there it is. I'm like right clicking on him. You see him start to do that, but then for some reason I just keep walking. I don't know. I swear I right-clicked on him. I guess I need to attack move in that situation. I don't know. I blame it on brain lag. I assumed the game was working properly, and it was my fault. I was so shocked. I was so shocked the moment this happened. And I'm like, no, you can't get away. But then he does. And then he also gets to give me a little bit of extra damage. I don't know what to tell you, Twitch chat, so. So, yeah, it is what it is. I drop a ward there. Trying not to let it psych me out too much. I think it's a little things like that today that has actually gotten in my head. So try not to let it psych me out. Go to Krugs. Try and clear Krugs. Speed this up a bit. A Mumu comes in, right? Mumu's coming for the gank. He sees me on Krugs. He's like, whoa, you're lower than I am. Let me attack you. Here's what I think of when I see this right now. I think, whoa, Mumu, let me get out of here. And it's like, right here, I think, wait a minute, this is a Mumu. Why am I running from an Mumu? Is this right? So I turn back. Once he's tanking the Krugs, also note, I turn back. I kind of juke away to, just like I'm kiting the Krugs, you know? I walk back, go into auto attack once my reset on my auto is done. Because I want to make sure the Krugs keep hitting him. I don't care if he's getting the last hits on these Krugs. I want him to be tanking their damage. It's very minuscule, but you'll see why. Like, we're going in here. We back away. We've got the rub buff slow, so we're trying to make the most out of that. I wasn't sure if Garen was going to come this way, so I was trying to give a little extra time. Wasn't working out. I actually get the E off on him, because he bandage tossed through it, which allows me to get the stun. Stun procs the Courage of Colossus shield, and then my W comes off cooldown. Just in time. That was close. That was really close. And I think I played that well in trying to let him tank the damage of the Krugs. Because look at that! If I didn't, he could have killed me there. And if he kills me and takes my Krugs and then gets some deep wards in my jungle, oh man, I'm not going to have a fun time. Oh, it's going to be a bad game. So thank goodness it worked out for us. There we go. So we're going to go back here. What did our first buy? We were waiting for boots is what we were waiting for there. So we got ourselves boots. I've been going Tracker's Knife a lot more often. Especially on tanks. Because even though I know for a lot of tanks it recommends the blue smite where you can steal some movement speed from them. I don't know, it just doesn't seem that useful. I already have a move speed buff from my W. I am not often going to be in situations like I was at the start of the game up here where I'm chasing Renekton. It's very rare that stuff like that happens. And if my E hits you, it slightly slows you. So between a move speed buff and a slow, I really don't need to steal any additional movement speed from them. I should be able to be well enough within range of them of what I need to be to make things work. So we go for rewards to get extra control of the jungle. Renekton gets a solo kill on Garen. Unfortunate. So I know Mumu's here. I know he was low. And that he just left mid area. So I gotta be thinking, okay, let me keep a presence bot side. Throw us down just to one check to see if there are any wards here. But also two to see if he's going across the Silk Road, which it reveals, and he's not. So I take Scuttlebutt. Good. Will give us a little bit more control over Dragon. Again, these speed shrines are great. Because, or crystal shard shrines, whatever they're called. Because they sort of telegraph whether or not... Excuse me. They telegraph whether or not the enemy is coming to try and contest an objective. But getting the speed shrine from Scuttle also helps... Because they can't cap that, you know? That's ours permanently for the next minute or so. So I go in here. I'm looking for the gank here. Or looking to get some pressure off. Maybe counter jungle and just see what's happening. See Mumu's here. Try and take these. Didn't even go for the last hit there. Because I saw them coming. Now, I think that's a pretty bad thing to do. I think... It was right to maybe just throw out the E and then leave. Let the E try and get a last hit. And then not even go as close to trying to last hit it as I did. Because let's look at that again, right? Let's look at it at normal speed, dude. We go hyper speed because in jungle, you have a lot of walking. And I can't... I can verbalize on stream what my thought process is. And I'm watching the minimap thinking like, oh, okay, with this vision... You know, I need to rotate here. This is happening here. Or, I was right side. This is happening here, so I need to think about this. And let's keep the shrine up and take that for this objective control. Because it's Fire Drake, it's very important. So this is always helpful to have. But you just see me walking when we're doing these lessons. So, I see him here. I think right now, just E. Right there. It's going to hit both of them. Might kill one, might not. But already we see that they're Mia. We knew that they were already kind of playing back defensively, keying us in that there might have been a ward we walked over that we didn't know about. So we should be expecting ourselves to be in a 3v1 position slightly while it takes time for our bot lane to rotate over. They are a very potent bot lane, and Varus in particular has pretty long range to start contributing to a team fight with his arrow. But, nonetheless, we don't want to tank unnecessary damage. So, let's see how far we go. Okay. So we went from here to here, and then kind of back. If we had instead gone this way after that, okay, sure, these are uncontested. The way to contest him is to walk in auto right now. I would have been punished even worse than I'm about to be if I had done that. So this gold, tangled, whatever it is, not worth it. Not worth it at all. I could be right here in a much safer zone. If I didn't try and contest these like a silly goose. Throwing that out there to sort of harass Amumu tangentially on his camp. Not bad. But being right here, much better. And here's why. Remember, already gone this far, I would have gone about that far. I'd be over here. That's why. So I'm a little slow on the ward. I don't remember if it had just come up off of a cooldown, but given it was from my tracker's knife, I imagine I just had it. So I should have thrown that ward as soon as I left the bush if I was going to go like that. Which I was going to poke my head out just to throw out the E and harass him. But now this is going to happen. I would probably still be condemned, but I would be condemned here against this wall. Nami wouldn't really be able to hit me with the bubble just yet. Because this is a kind of awkward wall for Nami's range on her bubble. Maybe she'd be able to reach me. Possibly not. But if this Krug weren't here, being a hero body blocking for me, Amumu could just go on me immediately. He could bandage toss to me, chain the CC with Vayne's Condemn, chain it with Nami's bubble. And that's a dead Skarner. I don't care how much of a tank I am. And yeah, I just take a lot of damage. I just get gifted this bubble here. There was just a misclick, apparently. And I get gifted this bandage toss. That's why I survived here. This should have been a dead Skarner. If that bubble was used on me, and this bandage toss was a little bit more patient to try and chain, I'm dead here. I still take a significant chunk of damage. They chunked me out about a third of my health there, third of my health. And I'm running, because I know that this was bad. I know that I'm lucky to be alive, shouldn't have been there. But now that we're here like this, instead of having gone here, I should be back here in the front line. I should be right at the tip of this arrow. Because then I throw out my E while she's stunned, walk down like this, stun her again right here. Varus will probably be around here. Easiest shot with his arrow that he's ever made. And that's a dead Nami. Easy. Vayne has to continue to retreat down here because there's no one to support her. Because Amumu's low and out of mana. Nami's low and CC'd chained the whole time. Free, free, free. Takes me that long to realize, oh, I should have been there. Look at that. That's what I'm talking about with Varus. He almost gets her anyway. So I gotta compensate for this, I think. You go for it. Can't quite make it. So I decide to back off. Think, alright. Played that poorly, but we need to get out of here. It's good, because here's Fizz, right? The Mias were coming out, the Rome was happening. We have Annie following up right here on the minimap, you can see. So, this isn't that bad. We have three people here. Annie's on her way from up top. Nami's almost a non-factor, because she's really low. She has some mana to play with. Amumu's completely back. There's no TP on Renekton, so he's nothing. We don't have a TP on Argarin either, but that's fine. And Vayne is the only thing here to support this Fizz. I mean, also the turret, theoretically, but that's it. So we can make this happen. Right now I should have turned on him. Instead I hesitate, right? Instead of turning on him when I'm here, and sort of boxing him into the space between me and Annie, this zone here, me going out this extra distance allows him to start trying to wrap around through here. So we miss an opportunity for a kill there. He playful tricksters away being Fizz, doing Fizz things. Looking alright. Try and shove this wave in as quickly as possible. And he's thinking, no, we're not letting them do that to us. I can get just out range of the turret. Summon Tibbers. Tibbers tanks the turret. We finish him off. That's what she's thinking. She gets it on Vayne. Doesn't get it on Nami, who's super low. She could have been killed almost immediately by that. Doesn't matter, though. Because as long as the damage is blocked, it's fine. Tibbers is tanking this whole time. I'm slow to react. Because of that, slow to react, Nami almost gets away. Thankfully, Annie gets the last auto off, so we're fine. I don't make anything happen that whole time. That could have been at least 3 kills. It could have been more. It could have been more summoners. It could have also transitioned into this turret. We could have gotten a lot out of an engagement like that. Something so messy. But I didn't get any involvement. This kills from when I 1v1'd Moo Moo in the jungle. I had no involvement down here in what was easily 3 kills served up on a platter for us. So a little unfortunate how the minions were there. They weren't quite. Also bad, given that we could have done this. I could have darted in and out of here, juking to make the minions curve up like this and stay in this zone here. Give them free time to work on this turret. It is early, and this is a fire drake, so I'm actually prioritizing going to the fire drake. That's fine. It's an alright play to make too. It's debatable whether or not the turret is worth the fire drake, because we could rotate back to the fire drake afterwards. They decide to join us because they see, following the correct old adage of, you know, don't make the best call, make the call that your team makes. You know, make it with them, make it. So we go over here, start working on the fire drake. They were all so low, they were all back in base, can't contest it. Free infernal dragon. I'll take it, not bad. Again, we missed a lot of opportunities down to get those kills because of, I mean, what's the right phrase for it, right? How I was positioned, how my target selection. Missed a lot of opportunities. I'm going to take this blue, trying to offer it to Annie. She said she doesn't want it. Okay, whatever. I'll take it and try and use an ult. I'm looking towards mid. Don't really see an opportunity, but I see bots pushed up. So I'm going for it. I pop my shield to get the extra move speed once I know 100% I'm in vision. Get condemned back. I was looking for a flash ult, and I was even going to take it on Nami. I was trying to get it on Vayne, but I would have taken it on Nami. Unfortunately, the condemn saves them both. I don't think it was possible for me to flash ult any sooner, and I've played that better. Just because I remember I was looking for it the whole time. I was waiting for that opportunity. I was like, just one little more closer. Maybe if I had thrown out the E, that could have helped. Just didn't quite seem like I could make it happen that time. I think we just, that's just one of those ganks you don't quite get. But I noticed how quickly they started to retreat, so I knew that this must have been warded. That was a good call. That was a good sweeper. Allows me to hop in this bush, peek around. They're playing so far back, I think that tribe brush is probably warded too. Start looking mid. Don't really see it happening. New Fizzle's low though, so he's probably going back. Probably can't contest this. Pull these guys over to the shrine. It's good. Good management, manipulation of the minions there to try and get additional vision. Pop right back over. Now I'm back bot lane. I'm looking for that ult, baby. Walk right in because the last hero caster minion is tanking. Right now, Vayne makes a really good play. She ults immediately and goes invis with her tumble. Pretty sure she's tumbling this way because of the shadow. I think it's a particle effect that slightly indicates where she started to move immediately after. Hard to tell. You could kind of see the particle effect afterwards, but looks like she went up. I'm looking, I'm considering ulting Nami, but I'm just thinking, no, we just wait out the Vayne, throw it on the Vayne. Boom, I finally get around to it. Now it takes me a little bit, and unfortunately, it's Bran that starts taking the aggro of the turret, right? Bran gets a really good ultimate off, he throws out all his combo, but unfortunately he does go down. That means this isn't gonna quite be worth it. I really want to make something happen here. This was just a bad call. One of the problems that I have is, once a play is made, if it turns out we didn't get the most out of that play that we could have, I tend to try and overcommit afterwards to overcompensate and try and make something out of it, right? So if somebody like tries to flash ult and they whiff, what I should do is immediately adapt to that situation and start playing way more defensively. But what I'll do sometimes is I'll then flash ult to compensate. So at least one of us flash ulted, right? You know, sometimes that works, but sometimes I just take free damage like this and have to burn flash for no reason. And I also soaked Varus' heal, which is why I, after the last turret shot, still have that much health. If he hadn't healed, I might have died even with the flash. Not good. Not good. Nami wasn't the one who got the kill. So this lane didn't really benefit too much from that. You know, it's whatever. It was fine, I guess. These two summoners over here, that happened because I had to flash like that. Bad. Bad, bad, sad, bad. Sad, bad, bad, sad. And this is where it goes from sad, bad to worse. We have vision. Right? We have pretty good vision because there's a ward here. I'm pretty sure I'm the one who dropped that ward too. We don't know where Fizz is. I'm not paying attention on the map. Right? If I had... I think this goes to earlier too, right? When we were down here fighting, if I had better map awareness of where Vayne and Nami were and how easily they could rotate up to this engagement and make this a 3v1 pincer, this would have gone a lot better. If I had had a little bit better awareness back here, map awareness of where our bot lane was in relation to the dive, okay, maybe Vayne could have still got off her invis through her tumble once she had ulted. But Nami was able to get a pretty money tidal wave to come out from her ultimate. She was able to land enough CC to where Bran died. And then I'm just not aware of, like, okay, we're low. There's no minions here to support after we trade Vayne for Bran. I need to not try and kill Nami. This is just silly. We need to just retreat. Don't have the map awareness. And I don't have the map awareness to realize, okay, Fizz is Mia. Fizz could be anywhere here, here, here. I need to just, at worst, I need to go up like this to try and get to wolves. But honestly, I should just go back this way and recall. I'm sure at this point in the game I had plenty of gold to spend. And we're going to see because I'm about to die. I might as well have gone and spent it anyway. So, yeah, no. Just a free kill. Didn't need to give it to him. Missed my opportunity earlier for the three kills. Wind up getting a boots upgrade. There's something else I'm waiting on. I end up just going with another ruby crystal, because I couldn't quite have enough gold to make the rest work. But so I needed to have better map awareness of where the mid laner was. And I needed to have better map awareness when trying to do that aggressive sort of invade into gank. Which I did both initially when I missed the three kills that were available, but then also when I roamed down from mid, from looking at mid and taking their raptors, razor beaks, all the way back down to the golems by using the blast cone over. So I'm farming out the jungle. Taking them topside. Nothing's gonna be happening about. I'm here in case somebody pops out, starts shoving it. Does it happen? After I finally clear these out. Takes a little while with skirmish. Best opportunity is to go mid. Start looking that way. Fizz isn't playing super aggressively because Annie's actually doing fairly well. They both aren't getting very many kills on each other, but they are getting kills, so they're playing pretty respectfully of each other. Means not a lot's going to be able to happen mid, especially with a champion that doesn't have the best engage like Skarner. So, I go here, look for the Skull Crab. I actually throw down, what I wind up doing once I get here, as I see that this minion wave is healthy enough to where I want to go for a dive. So I sweep out the brush, thinking that, okay, you know, there's probably wards either here, here, or here. If I was spotted by this ward going this way, it looks like I'm just doing scuttle, or I'm possibly going top. If there's no wards here. I swept it out, there's no wards. Very unlikely there's a ward at this point, at this time in the game. Unless if it was forced by some sort of shenanigans early on. So I'm coming around. I still have my ultimate. Annie throws out a lot of burst onto him, but has to back off because her cooldowns are up now. And it's Fizz, you gotta be careful. And she doesn't want tank turret aggro. So I walk over. Hitting the bolt. Serve it right up to Annie. Beautiful. That's the kind of clean money gank that a Skarner should be able to make. Served up on a fucking platter. And that was because, going over here, I had the awareness that nothing was going to be happening in top lane. I need to start rotating down towards mid lane. Not just go straight for the scuttle, rotate through the midway, and then when rotating, look to see if there was an opportunity to gank mid. And there was. And that's how you get that free kill there. That looked like a super free kill. And it's all because of the map awareness there. So, not bad. Not only critiques. I also have good map awareness on occasion. Let's see, down here. Start the scuttle. I should try and push it. I think I actually do here. Good. I was pushing the scuttle towards this shrine. So I could hopefully hit him while I was still on the shrine and get some extra value out of my time I was down. At this point in time, though, there was a cost to that. While I was doing all this, Annie was trying to roam bot lane and look for this kill. Because they were pretty far extended. Now if I just kept coming in, you know, I didn't have flash or ultimate, so I was thinking it probably wasn't likely. Looks like it probably wouldn't have worked out, I think. It was just Vayne by herself. Oh, and I don't think we even needed vision to know that, right? Because we see Nami top. Yeah, perfect. So, she's looking for it. She's charging her stun. But it doesn't look like she would have made it in time. I would have been even further back. Maybe like right here or like right here. Couldn't have dove it. This was the right choice. I had the map awareness to look at that and think, no, she's already backed off. I didn't have the map awareness to keep checking and see where she was here and see about how relative that was to my position with Annie coming in already flanking deep behind her. So I chalked that one up to a bit of luck on my side, that happened to be the way the calculations worked out. But, you know, an opportunity for some improvement there in my awareness. So Mumu pops his head out, so I'm thinking, all right, I gotta get around here. Okay, no, it doesn't look like there's more than one person coming. Great. No opportunity for a kill there. Annie's safe getting out. Let's just go farm the jungle out. Unfortunately, you can't pull Krug all the way or excuse me, pull Grump all the way into your shrine range. At least I don't think you can. Any other Skarner mains, let me know. But I'm pretty sure you can't aggro it that far with the leash range. Sweep out the pit because it's an Infernal Drake coming up and I really want to get it. Okay, let's go with this blue buff. Great. And he manages to kill Fizz on her own. Perfect. I'm going to finish this blue buff. Because again, Annie said she doesn't want it. And then we're going to look... Or excuse me. This icon is the Infernal icon. It always messes me up when I'm in the replay mode. It's an Ocean Drake, as you can see here. It's not the most important, but I am looking for it. Why not take it if it's for free? Garen rotates over here to help finish that. Perfect. We have even more control over this. We see a Mumu. Beautiful. He's hanging out around mid. Let's start it up. Let's take this dragon for free. Free dragon. Especially as they drop the bottom turret. Beautiful timing. Made use of Garen's room. Made use of the turret going down. The Trine Ward. Doesn't even matter. Perfect. Inbox topside. Start off by grabbing the Scuttle Crab for two reasons. One, because it's the most vulnerable, like, debatable camp. So I want to secure that one first. Just because I don't have much support around. So I'm going to grab that and then clear these three in back. I don't want to go here when I'm low. I want to give myself, if this is contested, it's the most contestable camp, I should have said. I can go ahead and just fall back and I'll have plenty of health to do so and still get my full clear off. So I'll start here. Plus, if there's an opportunity to make a gank happen, I can do that. So I start heading top because he's deep in the jungle. Looking for this. Here's a Mumu. A Mumu is actually getting the plant. It's all right. Coming here, gonna start on a Mumu. Thinking, okay, if we may not necessarily be able to get a Mumu, in that Garen's focus right now on killing Renekton, as he should be. His bandage tossed my hit. Let's pretend it was just a half a second before. Throw out the E, you can tell from this particle, it's not blue buff. That particle isn't, at least. That's my E on him, so I'm looking to just get an auto attack to stun a Mumu in place. And that means that gives Garen plenty of time to try and solo Renekton. And then we have a 2v1 all of a sudden. So that's what I'm hoping for, less than turning the target. As this happens, great. I'm still trying to position towards Renekton. Renekton winds up going down. Mumu throws out an ultimate, but I throw out mine just at the same time. So it actually allows us to pull him a little bit inward towards us. Wonderful. Garen gets the kill. Perfect. As intended. Nami's here. I was surprised for this. Because I didn't have proper map awareness. Right? And I'm talking about in-game live, right? We have pretty good vision control. Usually that means, oh, okay, I should know something's happening. It's true. The Fizz is already here, right? And now we see Nami right here. Don't believe me? Show you. Right there. Okay, maybe not right here, but right there. And Fizz is here too, because Fizz came first. Red team double kill. There's two here. Garen's very low. And I don't do a lot of damage. We need to back off. I can't burst a Nami. I actually see Fizz even. Not sure I realized Fizz was there. Bubble makes more sense. But Fizz is going on the Garen. I think actually once he was in actual vision, I saw Fizz, which is why I was trying to still path over this way to help Garen. But I definitely didn't see him rotate on the map. Afterwards, at least I did realize Annie was here. So this was a 2v1 for a little while on Tanami. I was trying to save my E so I could use it on Fizz. But seeing that she might get away because she exhausts me, so I'm slow and might not be able to get in range to proc the stun with my auto attack, I just go ahead and flash to take it to make sure we secure that this is a 2v1 and Fizz can't pull some Fizz magic, right? Okay, fine. Fizz gets away. And he actually chases him for quite a while. It's debatable that I should have helped her. I knew she was going to commit that hard to it, but whatever. It's fine. Seeing she's already down here. Go over here. Take the shrine. Since I'm already here. Trying to do some counter jungling. Now remember, I should know that Renekton's here, right? He had died in the gank. Correct me if I'm wrong, I'm pretty sure he died. Recall. But I'm pretty sure he died. So capping this shrine sort of alerts them that I am in this vicinity. So he just straight slices and dices over the wall here. Just on the off chance I'm here. No wards. Just on the off chance I'm here. To defend this for this exact scenario. What's it gonna cost him? A little bit of time getting back the lane, but his lane's pushing in towards him anyway. This farm isn't gonna be that affected. Might as well check. Maybe he can even solo Gromp on his way. So he can get a little extra golden experience in his pocket. Hey, he finds me. Uh-oh. I should have been expecting that because I should have known he'd be walking back the lane around then. Whatever, it's fine. I position up towards here. Because I know once I get in range of this this shrine's zone, I will be sped up to for sure hit the scuttle crab speed shrine. And then I'm for sure out. But once I'm there, I'm like, wait a minute, we got people coming. I have map awareness of these two, right? So I actually try and fiddle around with Gromp a little bit to keep Renekton interested to try and bait this. Bavaris breaks off and goes back. I should still kind of hang around a little bit supporting Bran. So I see that and do correct. Didn't quite give enough pressure. Again, luckily enough for us, Renekton backed off regardless, just sort of respecting that brand damage. And now, again, Annie's just popping off, killing Nami again. A little extra love was shown to her. Not too much, just a little extra from me. And now she's gone insane. She's become that Annie that, the little girl of nightmares, right? We're talking Bioshock kind of little girl of nightmares. Which, by the way, wouldn't you like to see a skin of Annie and Nautilus where she's the little girl from Bioware and Nautilus is the big daddy? Come on, we gotta... Like, I know it's already... There's already, like, fan art for it and stuff, but come on, right? Find a way to make that happen. I know there's copyright, but find a way around that. We can get around copyright, I believe. Anyway, so they're on this turret right now. Annie's even further, right? So even though we don't have vision of anyone, and two are down, so there's only two that could be anywhere else, Annie is the priority target for them right now because she's in between turrets. And this is like a full health turret, right? And some of her burst is already down. Like, she may have used a summoner spell in this engagement if they're not tracking her spells to already know that they're down currently for both of them. Her Tibber's burst is down, too. And she presumably wouldn't have her stun ready for a little while. So we need to take advantage of them focusing here and create pressure elsewhere. This is that easy pressure. There are already a bunch of minions here. These guys are already in perfect position to get damage on it. I just need to join them, pressure it a little bit more. So I do. We join it. Annie gives up on it, starts running away. But again, that immediately pulls the focus to us, so she can take a more aggressive recall. It's fine. We ended up getting this turret for free. Now, the aggressive recall got a little punished. There wasn't a ward she was on already, but they did check the brush. Sometimes that happens. We ended up getting a turret for, though. It hurts that it's a shutdown gold, so they get bonus gold off that kill. But, you know, it's going to happen on occasion. We got the turret from it. Rotating around. Throw down some vision. If I can try and start doing that again. Sitting on the shrine while aggroing the raptors to try and make a little bit better use of my time. But then the fight breaks out. A little while before I go there. But luckily they can disengage just fine. I actually said this during the stream as well. Oh, I'm so glad that they're able to just disengage when need to. Like, we already had the turret, the inner turret. There was no way we were going to get real significant damage on the inhibitor turret. So we shouldn't have taken any fight there. They had all the tools they needed to disengage. They unfortunately did have to use them, but they used them and we're fine. Gave me plenty of time to counter jungle. Push and move me a little bit further behind. Great. Take this scuttle. I'm not sure when the dragon's back up. I don't know if there's a... I don't think there's a way to see in the replay tool. But I'm just taking the scuttle sort of on my way. Might not be the most time efficient. Gets us a little extra vision on what is a largely dark side of the map for us right now. Because we've got... Is that... Yeah, there we go. We've got these two wards here. Well, the ward and the shrine here. That's about it. So having another bit of vision here from both the shrine and the move speed shrine from the skull crab is nice. Could have carried it back a little further, but just wasn't able to. Go for a full clear, or at least take the bottom side jungle for it back. Yeah, I do decide to back. My thinking is it's already too late for me to make something happen top. At best, I can recall and then go up there to prevent this turret as the wave crashes afterwards if they kill him and take the turret. So I just recall. He almost gets a Mumu. He almost gets Renekton. Too bad. I would have only been here, best case scenario, so it wouldn't have made a difference if I had gone there. I think recalling was the right decision. I think it was good map awareness to know to recall then. Unfortunately, they do get a kill down here. Not sure exactly what happened. It's fine. Doesn't matter. Spent a little too much time in base shopping around, but I like to put extra thought into my shop. And to try... This is going to be a really painful moment. To try and force myself to learn to habitize thinking about all those elements quicker so I can shop a little bit faster, buy a little bit faster, and get onto the map. But still be thinking about every aspect that I need to be thinking about. I'd rather sit in base 5 extra seconds and fully think out my buy than just auto buy a certain build and get out like 2 seconds quicker. I think it's more important to worry about itemizing. I didn't think I was going to make this, so I wasn't too worried about it. The missile actually stopped just short. I have my ultimate. I have my flash. I shouldn't have even tried to throw out the missile. I should have just flash ulted him and started pulling him back this way. That was a free kill. It was. It was another free solo kill in the same spot. In the same spot on a Mumu. And for some reason I had just decided in my head that he was going to recall faster than that. But I need to recognize... I need to recognize those opportunities, right? I didn't notice the exact timing when he started his recall. I just noticed that he was recalling in this brush once I started heading this way. And that's a little bit of map awareness too. Like, I should have known when he started that so I can know when it should complete. And if I'm in range for something like that, then I can just flash ult. I can flash anything to interrupt his recall and then ult. You know, I could have done anything else there that was a free kill. Let it go because I didn't have the map awareness to handle it. Come on here. Take the scuttle crab because Baron's about to spawn. Want to give us a little bit of permanent vision. Slam down the ward. Sweep out their jungle. see a couple awards here. Take down this one. I think that one actually expired on its own. Rotate over to this one. Alright, let's actually jump back. So, I can even go back further here. It was after taking the scuttle. I know Garen's splitting top lane, right? So this lane's going to be pushing down. This lane appears to be pushing out towards our turret. But we have outer turret. There's nobody from their team supporting it. It's not that big of a deal. This is a much more threatening push, and it threatens a much more critical objective at this point in the game. So this matters a lot. Most importantly, we're supported by our team right here, pressuring the inhibitor turret. So, very important that I go towards the team in case the fight breaks out. And if the fight isn't breaking out, rotate towards top as the wave arrives with Garen. Take this objective, give them the opportunity to disengage here without really getting anything. And then we will still get something because me and Garen will get the top turret. That's how you make rotational plays using map awareness, right? Fortunately, you get a kill here. Fight is breaking out, but it's a continued sort of siege, and they have disengage potential. Unfortunately, Big Fish makes this turn real bad. So once it kind of gets to that point, it's like, you know, I gotta just go and try and salvage something out of it. Becomes a salvage operation, right? Annie, since she's so fed, still manages to get a kill on the Fizz. I'm trying to just do my best to get this turret down. Nami's being annoying. I try and go as far this way as possible, away from Nami, because at this point I do have Bami's Cinder from the Cinder Hulk. So if she gets too close to me, this turret's going to aggro onto me. Now I could probably tank it, but I don't do a lot of damage, and there's not a lot of casters here supporting me. So I don't know how long this is going to take to actually drop. Try and not aggro onto her. Okay, great. I was able to get away with it. Renekton tries to come in, but the shrine, remember we captured it earlier. So just from the speed buff from my W, throwing on my shield, my crystalline exoskeleton or whatever it's called, I'm able to make it to this zone just fine. And this zone speeds me up, so I'm fine once I'm here. I even have another zone to retreat to. Completely safe. Go over here. Take the blue buff. Questionable play. But here's why, right? Remember, again, we still don't even have everyone fully respawn from the engagement that happened mid. But Garen's showing in what we know is their vision, trying to create pressure top. So they have to answer that. So I'm thinking, alright, if I don't see them answering him, I'm free to take this. Now theoretically, I could go straight here to try and get this dragon. But I don't want to leave him completely out alone, because I know that they are likely to rotate to him right now. So this kind of gives cover to him while giving me something in the meantime, and also counter jungling to Mumu, which is always helpful. So he backs off. Great, that allows me to leave. I take the blast cone out on my way just to deny further resources from their jungle. And then I head over to the dragon. Don't really care as much about getting those minions as I do making sure that this wave is going to push. Having these three caster minions still alive means that when the two mirrored waves crash, our wave is going to push overall, right? I don't know why I'm doing like super extra arrow to visualize that for you guys, but there it is. You get super extra arrow for our lane pushing overall. These three casters make a difference. Obviously, if you have a huge stack of additional casters in the back, they put out a ton of extra DPS and they shove really quickly. But if you have a few in the front, they body block for the melee minions, and the melee minions are already kind of slightly tankier than the other ones. Obviously, cannon a little bit more than melee, but definitely more than the casters in the back. So these give me a little extra shielding for the melees, meaning theirs melees will go down first, then their cannon will go down before our melees, or at the same time our melees do, but our cannon will still be up. The cannon is both tanky and a strong tool of DPS, so making it so the cannon is still alive really pushes the wave hard. These minions are enough collectively to keep, to tip the scales to have the cannon up to push. So that creates a lot of pressure for us mid lane. So that should free up this dragon. Even if they're already rotating down here, which they just revealed right now that they're not. But even if they were already on here trying to sneak it, they came over through blast cone or something. There's going to be work being done just by virtue of the minion wave being set up like this. So the pressure is going to be made. And even if they get away with this, they all flash back over the wall, we can just rotate mid with the shove and go back to the turret that's very low, that we left in a pretty low HP. So I rotate over. Vayne passes me as a ship in the night, as they say. Two ships passing in the night or whatever. Look over here. Was able to clear that ward, thank goodness. I had a little trouble clicking on that one, so I actually had to move behind it and then attack move to clear it. But I did. We get this. Annie engages. Even though we already had Brand zoning, Annie sees with Brand here, this is an opportunity for them just to both die. So it's both protecting us from being vulnerable to steal, and just making the most out of an opportunity because she has good map awareness to flash ult and just combo these down with another champion who has a lot of bursts as well, Brand. So great. We get the two kills there, we get the dragon, and now I'm chasing a Moomoo. He blue smites me, and this is a painful moment. I wanted to see this in the replay to you. Once it happened to me live, I was like, ah, Twitch, I want to review this game just so I can see this. Not the only reason, but I think it's about to go in the brush, so I need to flash right now, and I think that's within range. I want us to look very closely. You see the animation? I knew it! The animation started, but then he went into the fog of the war. So the animation cancels itself. Ah, brutal! Brutal! He didn't flash out of range or anything. It's just he walked into the fog of war there. So, very important lesson, right? I mean, it goes back to the map awareness generally. But if there's a situation like this, if somebody makes a play, and that means somebody's vulnerable, especially because he just threw down his only CC to maybe go to a vulnerable target, right? Now's the time. There's no reason to be waiting here. Just flash ult. At least now when he smites me, now I know he's going to get away. Now I have to flash ult. Instead, I'm not as aware that, okay, Annie did die, but we definitely won out in that trade overall, and Brand still has a lot of gas left in him because he has plenty of mana. I need to flash ult way sooner, and we have Varus following up. Need to be aware of dragging them towards there so they get free shots, right? I was a little wary of how that was going to work out, but it seems so one-sided in retrospect with Brand, who's very squishy, making it out with that much health. It seems like I should have flash ulted sooner and drug him over. It seems like that would have been better. Never escape. Instead, he escapes. Even though Skarner says he'll never escape, he escapes. Hashtag escaped. Okay, whatever. Get my counter jungle on. Trying to push this wave out. Again, they're creating pressure. I was hoping this wouldn't be answered. Because I should be... If this wasn't answered, this would be free damage on the turret with Brand. But once the wave pushed out, Brand could have followed me in rotating up to Baron. Since Annie's already coming through top, she could burst that wave out pretty quick and then join us. And then these two would already be there. Brand might be here to provide a little extra control over where the mid wave is. And we're getting free time autoing or bursting down Baron. Once I see that she's here, I need to leave. There's not much we can do, especially once Fizz shows up. He's way too aggressive. I try and pull Fizz away to save Brand. Doesn't quite work. Now there's four here. I do make it away. But I shouldn't have been there in the first place. Brand probably wouldn't have stayed there if I hadn't. And even if he had, and then the four of them came there to kill him, like they just did, we could all be on it. Varus could have rotated with me here after pushing out the rest of this midwave. Garen could have rotated up. And Annie would be, instead of heading to these Krugs, heading right over, taking this blast cone over the back. This would be a free Baron if, at this point, going back, if at this point, even a little bit before here, because you see that's 45 seconds we just jumped back, right? It's a lot of time. Right here, as soon as, even here would have been fine. Soon as she showed though, I should have just rotated right up here. Gone right through here, straight on over. How much time left here? About 30 seconds. Easily could be on Baron. There's four of them there that we saw, because Renekton showed down there too. Right? Free Baron. And Amumu's dead. It's not like they can contest it. I don't have the map awareness to realize, hey, somebody without TP is down here. Go pressure the opposite side objective. And, hey, their smite's not up because Amumu's dead. Go pressure the opposite side objective. I guess a better phrase to describe this is decision making. Because it's all, I feel like I'm trying to force the map awareness thing a little bit. This is honestly more about decision making, right? Because it certainly plays off of being aware of what was happening on the map. But that is to supplement making the right choices. Whether or not to fight for that skirmish. Whether or not to be rotating to this turret. Whether or not to be rotating to this Baron. Those were all decisions that needed to be made. And I'm about 50-50, maybe less, maybe more, so far. So I'm just denying a little resources, trying to maintain control here. No flash ult available. But I do capture the shrine. That gives us a lot of zone control here, because again, it seems like something that would likely... Some teams will run right by it to try and trick you and come out of the fog of war if you don't have wards to back this up. But a lot of times they will come here and capture this first because they don't know if a Skarner's waiting around and going to use the zone to try and punish them. So they usually cap it on their way to contest. So I'm trying to call over for Baron, but a fight breaks out. So okay, once I realize the fight's breaking out and is just going to happen, rotate straight over. Look for what I can find. Seems like we've largely disengaged. We're already down one on each side. So not a guaranteed fight by any means. And Annie, remember, at this point in the game, is a lot of our team presence. She is a lot of our team presence. So I'm just looking for what I can get here. Garen goes in on her. Good. Got his back. But he gets Vayne himself. Unfortunately, Fizz, where is Brand? I can't quite see. But Fizz is around wreaking havoc. I'm looking for the ulti. There's my Fizz target. There is a flash engage from a movie though. So that kind of pulls me out in addition to the playful trickster being used. Turn back, suppress Fizz. Because this is a Mumu. This isn't that scary. A Mumu is to amplify the AP damage that Fizz can dish out. If we kill Fizz, a Mumu isn't nearly as threatening. Now, Varus is dangerously low, but Garen can focus this Fizz with me. At least that's the thought. Doesn't quite work out perfectly, because Varus still goes down. A Mumu does have enough damage, just from the ambient damage from the Cinder Hulk. And his just rotation abilities, but we do get Fizz because of that. So instead of trying to turn and focus on a Mumu, that was proper target selection there. Ends up going down too. When you have proper target selection like that, you oftentimes get that person for free. And the second person for free when you get the first one. Garen doesn't have TP, so I'm trying to push this out and take this. Can't quite get it. Really want it. This was a mistake. I should have smited that initially. So all of these minions... Where's my... Come on. If I had smited that initially, these minions would be right here, and the turret would automatically aggro to them. And that would have given me enough time to disengage without tanking the turret for as long. Instead, I didn't have the proper target selection. There's the phrase of the day. To take out that cannon, I was worried about these guys, these melee minions here. Or these caster minions. Thought that was wrong. Which is fine. But I should smite, just right here. I should smite. I should have smited immediately as I was coming in. Right? I should have smited when I was right there. And then this is fine to focus these three grouped because I have a little bit of AoE. But I should have smited right here and then gave it a couple of auto attacks so like I knew this wave would be right here. Fortunately, I do it too late. Once it's after the fact. And I go back in for a pointless auto attack. So I wind up taking some serious damage, about a third of my health, maybe a quarter of my health, for free. Now that's really bad because I want to fall back to Baron. So I think, okay, well I can't fall back into Baron nearly as easily. So let me try and fight him a little bit. I got Annie coming as a reinforcement. So I'm trying to pick a fight with him. Luckily I do. I'm kiting back a little too far, but that's fine. Annie's here, we gain control of the position again. I decide to go back. I don't know where Vayne is, but I don't really want to run into the fog of war to check. So I'm back to base. Notably, possibly the wrong decision because I'm not supporting Annie, who is checking, and is counter jungling out there blue. That's an important objective I should be supporting. I was in base a long time there. I must have been waiting on an item. I'm trying to get to Baron, so I take the birds on the way. I'm getting scuttle while I'm giving them time to rotate. Fortunately, we're all down here, so a fight's about to break out. Right? Baron has to come support Annie because they're gonna get that one down here. He almost gets a kill on the Fizz. Doesn't quite get enough damage. Very close though. Brain has a lot of damage. But then now we're down. So I just gotta go push top, right? Theoretically, very low turret. But it's regened a little bit. So it's not like he can blow on it. And it'll collapse. But it is still low. So they are pushing. Varus running away because he knows they're over here. He's a disengage. It's an opportunity for an active engage on him. Fortunately, he doesn't take it, so Varus gets away free. Garen, giving me plenty of protection so I can continue to shove this out. So that's what I do. Unfortunately, dragon's about to spawn. Right? I'm thinking, all right, whatever. It's 27 and a half minutes into the game, and we have all the other dragons, right? If they take their first dragon, right, they commit all their resources, even if it's just the three of us while these two are still down, if they're taking dragon, we know at least their jungler is there, right? Probably Vayne is there. At least those two. We can take this, because I have ultimate. If they come and try and contest, we can turn on Fizz. I can just ult Fizz. And then Varus could use his ult to, when Renekton's trying to engage, throw it out onto him to get us a little bit of additional CC and lockdown to get us time. Could have been a free Baron. So I ping it out, calling it for the trade. See, it winds up being an Infernal. So that's just too important in their judgment. I get that, but at the end of the day, I'm already so committed by being so far up here and having target selected Baron that I'm not able to help with this. I think it would have been impossible for me to rotate down in time for this. Like, by the time they got there from them rotating here, even if I had started rotating immediately, I'd be at best like here. So I'd be largely a non-factor in this fight. I wouldn't be arriving till about now, which is when Amumu's like, okay, I'm gonna engage, you know? So maybe if this had gone down exactly the same and I'm here, I can make a bit of a difference in this fight. But I'm creating pressure top instead. I think it's fine. Kind of goes against the cardinal rule of support your team even if you don't think they're making the optimal call. But in doing this, I do draw Fizz up here, right? Which should mean that this is a more winnable fight for them on the bottom side. Now, they've already pretty much won it because they caught Vayne down. So I'm just like, alright, let me just get out of here. I decide, instead of just running towards my minions, because my minions aren't really going to do much for Fizz and Renekton. They don't really care that much. Renekton because he's a tank, and Fizz because Fizz doesn't care about anything. I think I just need to get away. So I decide to run over here towards this zone that's up so I can get a little bit of speed buff so I can get away. If I disengage, all that happened so far is Vayne died for free for us. Nami dies as well. So great. If I get away now, those two are super free. Draw my shield, the scuttle in addition to my crystal shrine. Give me tons of speed. Can't be challenged. I'm even like kiting a little bit, trying to keep them busy. Trying to tempt them to come over here. Can't quite find anything. Again, I still have my ultimate, so I am looking for a chance to slam that down on Fizz and drag him into Annie. Perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. I go for it. I flash. No hesitation. Bring him to Annie. She's able to burst him out. And then we can focus the tank. She has to pop barrier. She barely makes it. But because of that proper target selection, we got it. We got it. Tough. Close. But we got it. So, since we got him on an ace, two options, right? Shove it down mid. This turret might have regen since then. Or take Baron. Baron will lead into turrets. But if we can get an inhibitor, we can then fall back to Baron for free. Almost always free. I'm calling to go for Baron. Team calls for turret. I see there's more people positioned there. I think Annie's actually the one that did the second round of pings there. So we're fairly divided up. But once we're already here, now I'm the one calling to not do Baron at the end. The three of us are already here with the minion wave. So since we're already kind of in this position, and Annie is honestly the least factor, even though she's a lot of our kills and damage, and has Tibbers up so he can tank and put in some damage, She's not really going to be the main participant in either of our actions, because she might die to ambient damage from Baron. She might die as soon as Vayne respawns, as soon as Nami respawns. So even though I don't think this is the right call, I just start spamming out. Go with the team. Let's do it. Let's stay committed to the plan. We're already here. At least shove it into the turret. See if we can get some more damage on the turret. Fine. I called the tank it. Now this is a little bit bad of the map awareness, because I wasn't aware that they came up right now. So this is a little bit too aggressive. I shouldn't have just tanked it. I should have waited back here to see where they were before putting myself in a vulnerable position. And I almost go down for it. We are able to get it. In part because I did make the bold call to tank it. But I honestly think it's, with that Nami bubble, they might have been able to go in and kill me there. You know? Maybe Brand's ultimate dissuades them, so they can't quite do it. Maybe they weren't sure they were going to land that bubble on those two targets. It's very iffy. I do have a lot of health, or a lot of resistances. I actually just have a lot of raw HP. So I don't have that much resistances. I just got the Merc Treads and the Dead Man's Plate. I have some resistance. And a lot of health that Vayne can chew through. And I don't have much of it left. You know? So it was very risky. I think this is definitely too much. But stick with the team. Throw out my shield to tank what I can. Try and delay as much as I can. Okay, now we see a Mumu. Now we definitely gotta leave. Now the reason I think that's too much isn't just because I don't think we can get it in time, but it's because now we have to not only retreat, but we have to retreat, then I have to recall, then I have to walk my ass back out of base all the way to Baron again to resume the pressure. Amumu has respawned with new items, which he has Banshee's Veil showing, and full HP and full mana and smite available. That, in and of itself, threatens Baron a lot. Me having to back, in and of itself, threatens Baron a lot. So this is actually a fairly vulnerable situation. As soon as I saw Mumu land that bandage onto him, I decided to just run away from him as far as possible, so when he does throw out the Curse of the Sad Mummy, it doesn't hit on me. Try and dissuade them from following. Can't really go in and provide any support because Vayne's gonna kill me. So I just run. Doesn't quite make it to me. I have the shield. Make it to this in time. Have my zone. I'm fine. Fortunately, Varus does go down. That gives them huge control over Baron right now. Alright? I'm super low. I still haven't been able to back yet. I'm trying to keep enough pressure up to dissuade them from going. Annie finds a pick onto him. I'm low enough to where I shouldn't necessarily be in the front line. So creating at least a freeze again mid is actually fine. A fine target, air quotes, in the macro sense to select there. But that's great. Now that he's down, we actually have initiative over this Baron pit again. So I'm calling for some support here. Just looking to make it happen. Do a little laugh. I think, alright, if Annie's here, if she's ready for it, let's do it. Garen's nearby. Again, there's no smite to contest. With my shield, I think I'm able to tank this fairly well. And especially if Garen comes to help, we can make this happen. And we can rotate. Now, I'm slow to rotate off, which is important, right? If we see them coming like this, we do just need to rotate off. It's hard, it's always hard to start a Baron and then have to leave it. But I'm low, Annie's taking a significant amount of damage, and we all have the Baron debuff from fighting Baron. So we need to go, we need to be careful. I have my ultimate, there's no reason to not peel off and look for an opportunity to use my ultimate. I finally do peel, now there's three. So it's not just peel and look for an ultimate, it's peel and disengage. Now we want to stay in position, so Varus can come in. If Varus can find a good opportunity, we can follow up. Now it's four. 4v, like a scattered 1, 2, 3, and Annie's like a little bit that way four. So they are grouped in position. We don't have Wombo, right? We have Annie, but she's not Wombo. She's just Annie Burst, right? Maybe there's some Wombo combo technically, but like, he's in the bot lane. You know, Bran's not going to be participating. And because of that, even though we have the smite advantage because Amumu's down, technically all we got to do is just hang out. Because Bran, just by virtue of being in bot lane, will push that in and be gaining us control over the bot side of the map while we just do this Baron dance. We don't have to do anything here. So the target selection should be to disengage. There should be no target selection. Annie was preparing to use a blast cannon, realizes she doesn't need to, so she takes a position in the brush. We see Vayne. Okay, now we're 3v4 here, so wherever the three are. Now we can engage if we find an opportunity, but let's take the scuttle. Let's get ourselves a little bit better control of this objective. I throw down the smite because I have another one, so even if we immediately started Baron, it'd be fine. Focus that one to get ourselves some forward vision control. Then I go to the one in back to finish it off. However, I'm a little slow to that, right? Right here. We have pretty good vision of this area. So coming back to get this isn't that bad. We know Fizz is in this brush, but I want to get the back layer too, because sometimes people will throw down a ward here and a sneaky ward in the back. Right here is when I should know to go out the top side. Right? If I run through here, I'm pincering myself between these two areas by placing myself here. Garen might be able to make it out on his own because he's very tanky. He has like a kind of cleanse. He can cleanse a slow with his Q and give himself a move speed buff. And if I pull Renekton top, that sort of splits them. Garen might be able to fare better getting out with the 3v1 than both of us would with a 4v2. Maybe. And Varys is there to support him if needed, right? So I think it would be better for me to have gone out this way. Especially once we're in this position, right? Even a little bit before this, but just here. Well, now that we're here. There's three right here. Right? Now let me just move the camera slightly down so you can see. You can't see because they hop back in the bush, right? Fizz is here. Just remember Fizz is there, right? So Fizz is in that bush. There's two here, and Renekton's here. They're positioned most centrally around Garen, right? But Garen has an easy escape path. Garen's fine, really. Like, Fizz could engage on him and open up. That's like burning everything they have on a tank, and that changes the entire dynamic of this fight. I'm a tank, but one who has significantly lost a lot of health. But I'm not the central focus. This is a very easy exit. Even if Renekton goes in on me and stuns me with his W, I'm still probably fine. Especially because I'm in the scuttle zone if I dip through here. And I'm in my overall Skarner Shrine zone. So I've got some additional movement speed. So I should be fine to get out. Instead, I go this way. This is the only way to do this suboptimally. Because now I've pincered myself. Right? Now Renekton's behind me. He gives him time for Nami to land a bubble on me and chain the CC. Then Fizz can come out and start doing damage on me while Vayne condemns me against the wall. That's so much chain CC they have on me. This is just a horrible choice. Horrible decision to be made. They throw it all out on me. I die. Amumu just now respawns. Four of them are already at the Baron pit. This is how you lose a game that you won. This is how you lose a one game right here. Mumu's back. Five people, Again, Vayne's dipping in and out of vision. There's almost always one of them that's dipping in and out of vision. But their whole team is right here. Our team still isn't fully grouped. And now the jungler is dead, so there's no smite to contest. They get on it. They're fighting. Lucky, lucky, lucky us. Amumu trying to make the hero play. Comes across. As soon as we kill Amumu, I'm like, that's it. They have to all flash over this wall right now to win this fight. And if they don't, they can't take this because they don't have smite. And even if they do, they probably lose enough people to where they still can't take this because they don't have smite. They come in the meat grinder style one at a time. They wind up getting our Annie, which again, matters a lot. She's a lot of our kills. But Garen's really fed now too, right? So we retain control. They're down three, they're down two. They wind up getting the last two on their way out. Even Vayne can't kill this Garen. Garen's too fed. Not much more, I don't think. Can we just push it out? Take this in head. Rotate over. Take this in head. At this point in chat, I'm calling, okay, take the inhibs. Come to Baron with me. Thinking, okay, we Baron, we recall back to base, spend our gold, rotate through bot, get the last inhib, get the base. Nothing they can do to stop it. Textbook. Get this. Mumu can't find the engage he's looking for. Winds up having to leave. Get the second inhibitor. They're coming up. I'm pushing out the wave to bring them a little cover. Now I'm coming up through here to throw down vision. Sweep out some of the vision. Beautiful. Textbook. Nothing they can do about it. There were some rough decisions. Some rough errors in some decisions. Some rough errors in some positioning. And some poor map awareness all sprinkled throughout this game. I think we're going to go with target selection as the main theme of today's episode, but going after this, decide not to recall just because everybody's like so healthy still. We all have Baron. Like, I didn't have a lot of gold or like a specific item I was wishing to turn this giant's belt into. Oh, if only I could hit that next tank item power spike. So, thinking again, I actually mess up the micro on this a little bit and like have to try to get that speed shine three times. But then we all group because of Moomoo's bot. We have some minions here. Can't quite end off of this. Take a little bit of damage, but largely insignificant. I try and rotate towards these to give these the Baron buff so they can get in here too. But I get engaged on them. This is a good ult. We're going to take a moment and appreciate this ult here. Because this flash. Because this is rarely intentional. A lot of people will do this just out of like coincidence. As soon as I saw this, I was like, oh god, he's going to kill me. He's going to ult me. Or he's going to, like, now he's going to flash ult the three of us. So I'm immediately going, and I see him continue to walk to position. It's like, alright, now's my chance. I can dodge his ult, and I can flash into ult range of Vayne. I actually nail it. Any hope they had died right there. All these Baron minions. We have supers that are Baroned up. That's game. So, overall, it was played fairly well. Enough to where there wasn't, like, even that clear of a theme to today's episode. I think we're going to go with target selection. Just because that seemed to be the thing that stood out the most. Target selection and map awareness, it's close, but I think the map awareness sort of works into supplementing the target selection. It's arguable that that's, like, a... what's the word I'm looking for? It is a trait of proper target selection that you have good map awareness. So I'm going to say overall target selection needs to be worked on. There are some good plays that I'm getting. Like the fact that I could recognize in-game in the heat of the moment when I'm sort of frustrated that I just died, and then they should have gotten that Baron for free, but luckily they didn't. A greedy engage to try and get kills on the back of it as well. So it threw me off my game a little bit, but we were luckily able to make the right call, see the right play, see that we could sweep those inhibitors, take the Baron, go to bot if we needed to. Then we didn't even need to. We just went mid, waited for the picks, and still had the opportunity to do a clutch flash like that. That's good. The mental fortitude there to still have proper, you know, rotational awareness and play decision-making is good. But the decision-making all throughout the game could still use some work. So, you know, always room for improvement. Just because you don't do, you know, horrible, have a lot of glaring errors, doesn't mean there isn't a lot of opportunity for improvement. And, you know, that's what we're here to do. We're here to not necessarily go from the worst player in the game, bronze 5, to the best player in the game, challenging Faker in the international tournament, you know? We're not here to be LCS. We're not here to, you know, dredge ourselves out of the absolute worst mindset. I mean, you know, I think people of all levels can learn something from this. I've mentioned this on previous streams. I'm not sure if it made it into one of these lessons, but I started this season in Bronze 1. So I think, although I didn't start making the episodes until later on here in Gold 5, I think there still are lessons you can take from these that will be applicable to yourself, even if you are as low as Bronze 5. Like, these are lessons that are very readily applicable to you. And again, I'm not executing these things perfectly, even though I think I had okay target selection this game. Certainly wasn't perfect. Certainly a lot of opportunities to improve there. So if you can find some opportunities to improve in your target selection, maybe you're not going to have quite the target selection of a Faker. But nobody does. You know, that's why he's Faker. So hopefully you learned something from that. If you know somebody who could use a little bit of help with their target selection, feel free to share this video. And, you know, join me in the live stream. Hang out, chat, talk about what games you'd like to see reviewed, what concepts you would like to see go over. I'll try and find a game that matches that concept. If there's something you're particularly working on, whether it be focusing on how to rotate properly to maximize your CS, just core mechanical last hitting, trying to do some sort of mechanics with a certain champion. I know the last episode was a little bit more Zyra focused, in particular to not just a large concept like target selection for a jungler, which is a little role specific, but can apply to everywhere once you hit late game. If there's any roles in particular, I'm just playing as Phil right now. If you'd like to see more games about the jungle, if you'd like to see more games about the ADC, hop on in Twitch chat, let me know. Otherwise, I'll see you guys in the next episode. Thanks for watching.